Programs we've discussed the histories of mind control. Basically, we've gone through the histories of ancient religions, how they started up with civilizations, the meaning of civilization, the money system, which is part and parcel with religion in this system called civilization, the techniques to control the peoples, which haven't really changed that much. The same techniques are used, only on a much larger scale. And plus, they have children in school to start the indoctrination process early and to giving them a type of version of reality, which generally they will never question their whole life long. They accept the world as it's been presented to them. Many, many thousands of years ago, civilizations rose and fell. And really, by civilization, we're talking about the creation of artificial systems. Money, of course, is an unnatural thing to use for barter. It's of no use in itself. It's supposedly a tool. That's how it's pushed over through economics. It's a tool which helps barter. It helps barter, you see, by introducing a third party. And of course, those who introduce the money ultimately control those who barter and those who buy. From money, of course, they build cities. City is an artificial hive, a beehive, as Plato called them. And through cities, these civilizations, really all one civilization under many faces, through the cities they could, because they must use money in a city and they can't grow anything in a city, they can't feed themselves, they're totally artificial. A culture which is fluid and flexible is not a natural thing, at least we don't know what natural culture ever was. But it's definitely flexible and pliable, and it's a science in culture creation. is still ongoing. Now, those who know how to manipulate it had their start in the cities, where once they have money on the go and they've trained the people outside to accept money for their food products and so on, they then get a standing army from within the city, and with the standing army they go outside the city and conquer other peoples, force them into the system, force them to use money, give them a religion, and really they're really slaves. And as Charles Galton Darwin said, the grandson of Charles Darwin, he said that every civilization has really been a form of slavery for the people. And he was all for it. That was a natural order, according to him. And of course, those who are trained in power and control of the people are trained in this technique since birth. They're brought up listening to a different version of reality than someone brought up in a local housing area. They're told that the realities of life, the predators which should be at the top of the natural order. The predators, of course, because they're such hypocrites, are good predators. They can't tell the children how they're really feeding off them or manipulating them for different ends, because children don't understand these things. And those with the low IQs, you know, the little people at the bottom of the hill, you got to keep them in the dark. The profane. Profane in masonry means those in the darkness, base people. Which is a real hypocrisy in itself, because it's like breaking the legs on a cow and then kicking the cow because it can't get up. That's the hypocrisy of this system, and that's how they view the public. They've broken our legs and then they hate us because we can't get up. We're pathetic. And of course they claim that we need them. It's like saying that the mice in the fields need the hawk. This is the logic of the predator. From the days of Babylon and before Babylon, they call them the Harappans. This is the name that's been stuck on these people by historians just to give them a name. But the Harappan culture extended all the way from Egypt right through the Middle East to China. And now they're unearthing pre-Sumerian Harappan cities on trade routes. And of course they must use the money system to live that very high standard of living, these merchants. And they even had indoor plumbing, you know, something that some people today don't have, and even in Canada. In some places. If we go into the Minoan cultures, we'll find the Minoans in the Aegean Sea controlled all the trade routes, they controlled all the merchandising on the sea, land and everything. And they also had indoor plumbing and central heating even, and hot water for bathing in and showers even. And they lived an extremely beautiful lifestyle. They had painted frescoes in every room and hand-painted. And that was supposed to be a wonderful existence for this high ancient elite, who obviously didn't create the culture themselves or the system. They had got it from a previous civilization in turn. And so we come to this impasse where we're looking at people down through the ages who are intergenerational, and who passed this system on to the next. And now, of course, that does seem to be what really is all about, because dynasties and power never give up power. When they do move, because it's their turn to lose in warfare, because they have turns, you see. War is to create change and to make profit, not for what the public thinks it's for. So sometimes the ones who decide, well, we'll lose this time, they will actually move to generally their enemy's camp, which is their friends, and share the loot and bring up their children and slap the name of the country on them, and they don't care what they call the country. The elite never ever get massacred or wiped out with their wealth. They just move. They move all down through the ages. They bring on catastrophes to an empire when they've used that empire up. And they've already created another one to move into. Then they flatten the old one and move on. And this has been the system for thousands and thousands of years at least. The trick of Darwin was to make you think we just evolved in, 200,000 BC, and before that he even said 10,000 BC, which is rubbish. This whole evolution thing is actually a Masonic doctrine. It's nothing to do with what we think it's meant to be. It's a Masonic doctrine. So Darwin just was pulled out the hat by the Royal Society, which was a Masonic scientific establishment chartered by the British Crown to exist. And he basically gave the origin of species, etc., to justify the right of certain types to rule. And he wasn't talking about other animals over animals, he was talking about themselves over us. So evolution is a caste system. It's to verify a caste system, to reinforce it. And of course, it's worked very well up until now. So going back to the Minoans, we know that they also shared, and they were probably very much so, a part of the Egyptian, ancient Egyptian elite. Because the frescoes on their walls have the same imagery, styles, techniques used as you'll see in the frescoes inside some of the tombs inside in Egypt. And even had the little curls down at the front, the locks of the youth that they used to depict youth in Egypt. So yeah, it would make perfect sense that a real elite, you see, wouldn't live in a place where they could be easily attacked. They would have a front, an empire or a city, and come in and out of it, certainly, but they would always have somewhere safe, such as the middle of the GNC. And we know, for instance, that in a circle in the Aegean Sea of little islands which are left after a volcano goes down, that they had that huge island there at one time, and islands like Terra are the remains of them. When the center of the volcano sinks into the oceans, little fringe ones remain and become separate little islands, and that's where we get much of the Minoan history from. Interestingly, Minoans used a double-headed axe in the religious ceremonies, the symbol of the fasci, which has come down through the ages. So we're looking at something that the Catholic Church used afterwards, thousands of years later, because the Minoans were around 5,000-6,000 BC. And here's the same symbology used by the Roman Catholic Church, who simply inherited their culture from the Greeks who moved into Rome. That's the elite, that is, of course. And brought all this symbology with them. The Greeks got it from the Minoans. So this is an endless stream of symbology down through the ages, a language, you might say, which they understand very well. And which some very high Masons understand, and which some people who are natural adepts can figure out themselves. But there's not very few of them. But the Catholic Church used this Minoan fasci of the axe with a bundle of rods around it, meaning strength was in numbers. As strength, when you get one twig, you can break it easily, but you get a whole bunch of them in a bundle and try to break it in one go, it's harder. And so the nobility, the ruling elite must stick together at all costs, you see. And in the middle of all the bundle is the main shaft of the fasci, the actual axe itself. So this is also in the Senate, on the Congressional Hall in the U.S., where Mr. Bush now gives his speeches and every other one before him has. On either side, you'll see the fasci, the symbols of the fasci, the system of an elite encircling the center shaft. And they're all tied together, they're bound together by oaths, you see, in blood and money and so on, and their own secret religion. So yeah, we're tracing a system going back, way, way back into the mists of time. Civilization to the elite is that which is abnormal. They create the abnormal. They are the deviants, so they create the abnormal. Nothing normal can come out of deviancy. That makes sense. So you got an artificial system which conned. The word con, con, can, cane, king, all comes from the same root of priest. They conned people to use money. And then, of course, they could create their cities, hire people for a standing army. You can't keep a bunch of guys together to go and conquer anybody if you don't have some means of keeping them there, some kind of reward. They'll just go home eventually, get bored and fed up. So money, it was always the key to this civilization, this building process, building of cities, empires, society itself. And Freemasons like Albert Pike and Mackay and a whole bunch of other ones are always extolling their own virtues of being able to build society, build culture. And just like the Middle Ages, where they built their cathedrals and their big huge churches and so on, they'd often build them either next to or on top of existing ones. And so as they're building a new one, they're demolishing the old age, the system is buried and demolished as they're building up the new. So we have an elite who've used war, money, cities, culture creation, religion, and all the things that come into the culture, festivals, generally it's based on lunar and solar and stellar mythologies to keep the people in check, keep them happy, dumb down, stupid, and obedient, more than anything else. It's obedience is so important. And of course, the sun god was one of the greatest ones that used down through the ages up until the present day. It's a reincarnated sun god, you see. It's the same old thing rehashed over and over. Where the invisible god, the grand architect of the universe, as the Masons call him, always chooses a son to his own son to push life into the world, because they claim that without it, we the profane are dead, you see. And in a sense, they're right there, because if you don't know reality, you are dead. Because living as a human means you're a sentient, aware, fully conscious being. So you'll find in all religions they'll have the same terminology. And you find it in Christianity too, where Jesus says to the guy, let the dead bury their dead. And ministers don't dwell on that because they can't really fathom it out. How can those who are walking around bury the dead? It's because the life, it doesn't mean you're animated. Which is the big con today. Everybody's rushing around in their cars as fast as they can go. And they think they're living because they keep moving. And they don't do shopping lists anymore. They've got to just keep moving and have noise blaring all the time and music playing or something, you see, because they're scared to think.
Mount hit 'em up, raw high. Take 'em out, ride 'em in, cut 'em out, ride 'em in raw hard. Ha! Ha!
And those who will not think for themselves are classified as the dead in all ages. George Orwell used that even in his 1984 book, where Winston and his girlfriend are caught by the thought police before being taken to the Ministry of Love for torture. And that's what he says, when they're first caught, we are the dead. We are the dead. That's a little sonic giveaway. Meaning, though, if they'd been really alive, they would never have been caught like this. And of course, there are many, many degrees of waking up from the dead. And in Freemasonry, they have a substitute bunch of rungs on a ladder called degrees for the idiots who join it at the bottom to get up, thinking that one day they're going to hit the big magic number and they're going to be a full-fledged high chutzpah, you see. And they get virtue. Taught virtue. All these drunkards and guys who've done everything everybody else has done suddenly have virtue, and they think, oh my goodness, I'm a 32nd degree Mason of the Scottish Rite, and I am illumined, and I got virtue. as they cross their palms with silver in their handshakes and pay each other off, you see, and take all their freebies from the society they live in. You know, cheaper taxation assessments with a little nudge, a wink and a nod and a handshake to the assessor. And the same thing with the policeman that catches them speeding, you know. Ah, is there no one to help a poor widow's son? Why is that? Why? Why is that? Why? So you get all this rubbish, you see, and these guys are just bottom feeders. They're low-end predators, because who else would join a society with secrets, as they call themselves, without knowing what it's all about? All they know is what the Masons make sure that everyone's always known. If you join us, you get up the ladder in life. You get little special favors. So this is the rubbish, you see, that goes into Freemasonry, the low-level bottom feeders, because they want all the little freebies, and it doesn't matter to them if their neighbor, who's a profane one, now this guy who's exactly the same as them, is now profane, if he gets a bigger tax assessment, and he has to pay his speeding charges and so on. It doesn't matter to him that this guy is suffering while he's not. That's the Masonic creed. It's to scratch my back and I'll scratch yours. Dogma, you see. But of course it doesn't stop there, because a circle is 360 degrees. And these little prunes don't go up terribly high, especially first generation Masons, because there's also a breeding program involved. And we can trace this back down again, way back to Sumer and so on, of intergenerational breeding and selective breeding. So don't let Darwin think that he came up with this idea himself. In fact, you'll find if you dig into history, his grandfather had all written a book about it long before he did. It was a Masonic dogma he was preaching, the right to rule by an elite, you see, a superior intellectual elite, who are not afraid to use aggression and kill if need be. Always for your own sake, you understand. That's a good predatory excuse. But somehow we can rationalize that. But then we are the children, and what do we know? You can't scare the children by telling them the truth. And in a sense, at the stage we're at today, that is true. In a sense, it's very true. The children don't want to hear it. So you got an endless seam of merchandising, money lending, interest gathering, priesthoods going down through the thousands and thousands of years, and intergenerational families who are taught a different reality than the ones at the bottom. They go to the little red schoolhouses. In Britain, it's little red brick schoolhouses, as the elite refer to them. Of course, their universities are also granite stone, where the honorary muck can go to the red bricked universities. Margaret Thatcher, back in the early 80s, came under fire, in a sense, if that's possible. For subsidizing private schooling for the wealthy, using tax money to subsidize the wealthy. And she rationalized it by telling the truth, as they very often do. And she said, this is where your future leaders are coming from, your future industrial leaders, political leaders, economists, and so on. They come from these schools, and this is where they meet each other. They'll grow up in life knowing each other and all be in the right positions. And she was telling the truth. There's nothing strange about that. They do tell the truth very often. It's the public who, when they hear it, they say, I know I heard that, but they can't really mean what they say. So the public who are trained this way, you see, you train the abused to love the abuser. The public can't quite fathom this, and so they make excuses for them. Well, I guess she had a bad day to say what she said. Well, the problem is that she's got on her plate. I don't blame her. You see, this is the rationale. So, an intergenerational elite with many priesthoods. I mean, Sumer had so many priesthoods dealing with the legal system and even real estate and subdivisions of real estate and wills, death duties and taxes and so on. everything that bureaucracies do today, some of the change their clothing and wear suits and ties today, or white coats like scientists. So the system's gone down through the ages, always taking themselves to another place and destroying that which they left behind them. You're leaving it in such a way, leaving some low-level controllers there to make sure it's standardized. That way, when they get a bigger empire over here, they can then lump this back into it again, the old one. So they create bigger and bigger empires, and this is part of the great work, as they call it, that they claim began in 4,500 BC, that the big idea, as Mr. George Bush Sr. called it, the big idea, the BB, to be or not to be, says Shakespeare, for those who know. So on they go down through the ages until they see their target in sight. And they told us it would be the age, you see, of Aquarius. There's many reasons for Aquarius being Aquarius. But it's got it even in the New Testament, because Jesus was a sign of Pisces, a fish, fisherman of men. The first guys who were recruits were fishermen. The philosopher king of Pythagoras type of thing. And the early Christians used the fish symbol wherever they went as a sign of Christianity, before they used the cross. And in fact, the cross was used for the inner sect, because it's always an exoteric for the public and a real meaning for the initiates. So the cross was always used as a symbol of the sun, but the fish, of course, was for the public, for the profane. So Aquarius has has ruled for over 2,000 odd years. And now we're going into Aquarius. So in the New Testament, they have Jesus saying, go into town and you see a guy carrying a pitcher of water, which is Aquarius, of course, and you borrow his coat. And so they managed to even write it in there, you see, to give you the clue that this would be the time for the next coming, you see, of man, the new type. The age in Aquarius of peace and understanding. Well, peace is not peace as you know it. Peace comes when there's absence of consciousness and opposition to this agenda. That's what they mean by peace. And peace comes when there's not enough of you to cause the trouble, and those that are left don't have a functioning brain to use. That's peace. And hence the rush towards chips and chipping the brain and implants and stuff like that, and a totally controlled society. They want peace. They don't want to give us all this media nonsense, you know, this constant propaganda to keep us running in circles and, you know, chewing the grass like good little sheep. And it's also, it takes away from their profits, because they want pure profit, you see. They want 100% profit from us. And they've got to allow us to entertain ourselves, to keep us obedient and grazing, and sports and circuses and all that kind of thing, you see, and buying toys, junk from China, as rewards, little Pavlovian rewards at the end of the month, you know. That's all taken from their ultimate profit. And that upsets them, because it's not efficient enough. And the system that's coming into being is to run on complete, utter efficiency, where a person will not be born unless they have a work for you to do. Unless you can sell your body parts as a fetus, mind you, as long as you get some profit from it, from an investment. And we're going to down through a horror show down through the ages of watching people being oppressed, doing what they do naturally, which is to resist. So you have force, and for every force there's an equal and opposite reaction. And then, of course, then they control the conflict to bring out the conclusion, the synthesis of it all. And before you know it, we'll just move into where they want us to go. It's when we are the sheep, they are the good shepherds. Good shepherds pat the sheep, they know them by name. The sheep come up to them and like them, because sheep don't know what they're there for. They think they're there to be happy. Huh? They don't know. They don't even ask the question, why does this shepherd spend so much time taking care of us and talking to us? And it's because the sheep don't know what they're there for. They don't know their function is to feed the shepherd, make a profit, and so they take the wool and fleece them. You see? That's a good shepherd. A bad shepherd sharpens his knives in front of the sheep and slaughters one. The rest of them are terrified. They run off when they see him. So the good shepherd wears a suit and tie and says, I promise to help you, whatever category you put yourself into, whichever pigeonhole, ready-made pigeonhole you put yourself, I'm left wing, I'm right wing, I'm up, I'm down, whatever. Well, it's there, it's their system. And they lead you to where they want you to go, which is the abattoir. But you're not supposed to know that till it happens. Poor things, you don't frighten the children. So you tell them what they call in masonry the noble lie. And they give us noble lies all the time. But we can't tell the people the truth, poor things, they wouldn't understand. And so they've had debates down through the thousands of years and how many they needed for work. Of course, when they needed lots of labor, they bred them up and told them to procreate, go out and multiply, yada yada. And they did, and they slaved away quite willingly for their masters. And when there were too many of them, that the elite would get together and say, well, let's have a war and call some off, you know. And they do that too. And of course, since really the 1500s, when the Rosicrucian movement broke into the surface openly in England, that's when the real push was on for now a more expert-run society. And in the 1700s, it really took off with all the different writers amongst the interbred elite, like Charles Darwin. Charles Darwin's family only interbred with one other family for generations, and that was the Wedgwood family, the famous pottery Wedgwoods of England. And his grandfather married one, his father married one, Charles married one, and then when his wife died, he married his mother's sister, another Wedgwood. So they're all Wedgwoods and Darwin's all mixed together, you see, until they bring in some other outside blood, the Galtons, another sweet bunch who believed in population reduction. And so they end up with Charles, but anyway, he had 10 children from his first wife, and eight of them died in childbirth, and the other two died in insane asylums very young. Two interbred, you see. But that's part of the program initiated by the elite through Rosicrucianism, when they had to build up a middle class to manage what was coming, an industrial era, and even a middle class of obedient middle class people who would in turn look down the noses of the people they just left, you know, the bottom of the heap. So the middle classes would become very snobbish, they'd have their own version of masonry, not a noble order like the elite had, but they'd have a version which they didn't know there was anything else except the one they joined. They thought, this was it, I've made it. I'm climbing up the mountain. So this con game's gone on and on and on. And of course in the 1700s with the French Revolution, we see it coming to a new open dimension. We see it opening up, where they actually killed off during the revolution thousands and thousands of ordinary French peasants. Because it wasn't just the elite they were going after, they wanted to cull off what they thought was excess population in the provinces of France. And they towed them out in barges and blew them up and stuff like that, you know, very sweet. This was their idea of a scientifically run society by an intellectual elite. This has gone right on until today. We are now run by so many bureaucracies and expert NGO groups that speak for us, even though we don't know who they are. This is just running the world today, a world run by the natural order, they call it, just the intellectual elite. Those who have proven, as H.G. Wells said, they have proven through history and through the wealth their families have accumulated for centuries, that they are the natural elite. They have the right to control the lesser. You see, those and profane, those guys at the bottom of the hill there. You know, the guys that Moses left behind. And that's the story about Moses, of course. Moses wasn't a real person. It was a myth that was borrowed from Egypt and before that from India. And it's nothing to do with a person as such, or a wandering captive people. It's the natural order according to the mystery religion. Because the so-called Israelites, who'd been slaves, were still slaves, you see. They were still base people. So in the story, which is exoteric and esoteric, they're down at the bottom of the mountain, and it's lightning and thunder going around there, so they can't get up. They can't follow Moses up the mountain, because only the illumined man, you see, illumined man, the one who's illumined and has spirit. You see, the profane don't have spirit. Here's the big secret, you see. You're base, you're creatures of instinct, as Paul said in the New Testament. So the mob, who are slaves, stay slaves, basically. And they stay there, and of course, being slaves and dumb and stupid, they make a golden calf, because the slaves, the base ones, want a two-legged, or at least a four-legged, something solid anyway, to worship. They don't want a god or something that they can't see, feel, and touch. They want to worship something physical. And so Moses, the illumined one, goes up the mountain, up the degrees, up the scale, to talk to God. He went where the rest could not follow. That's what it means. That's a simple esoteric story of it. And Moses, of course, in Egyptian, means child. Unless you become as a child, you cannot see the kingdom of heaven, you see. Ramoses is child of Ra. Thutmose is child of Thoth. And on we go. So we've been under tremendous mind control for such a long, long, long time. We still are under tense control. And the Masons are, again, in their own publications, will tell you there was a Masonic push to have universal education, the same education worldwide, to standardize with a bunch of schmucks who will never question reality, who will accept reality as it's presented to them from birth. And that's what good management means. The schmucks don't know the schmucks. When you see them, the people coming out of colleges and universities, they wear the cloak. You see, the cloak used to be always black for Saturn. Now they use red ones. I've noticed they're very popular. A sort of pinkish red, actually, which is maybe more telling for both sexes. And if you're an architect, you see, or an engineer, you understand technical drawings. You see things in a way differently from other people, because most people see the solid front of an object. They don't see the different aspects, the front view, the top view, the side view. They don't picture it in their minds, but the architect does. And of course, when you're wearing a little hod, as the brick masons call it, where they used to use a hod where they carry the bricks up the ladder. That's where they put them on. And that square there represents that, you see. The little squaring off the head. So the round head is not natural, the rolling stone. And the perfect squared head, you see, the ashlar, they call it in masonry, is now perfected. So nature wasn't good enough. By themselves, they will perfect nature. And that's what they say in masonry. They're here to perfect that which is left imperfect. Well, guess what that means? Everything. Including you. And if you look from the top view, of course, one of these little square-headed people with the gowns on, the dresses, you know, you'll see that. You'll see the square. And if you were to see the head beneath it, you see the square, the circle, but in the middle, it's squaring off the circle. See, that's what it means. Squaring off the circle. Squaring off your brain. A brick in the wall. And it really means that you've got a quality approval stamp on you by those who run the system, that they've dumbed you down and you're now stupid enough to work in their system and fork over 40-50% of your earnings to them, you see. In the old days, they needed a few slave drivers. Slave drivers take away from your profit. And who watches the slave drivers? You see, so we are self-maintained slaves through money that we think is natural, like gravity, simply because it exists in our time when we're going to live. And that's how easy it is to control us. we are self-maintained slaves. We were trained for one thing, and that's work in a system to produce and consume. And whether you're producing or consuming, with all the sales taxes, you're still paying lots of tax money. And, of course, that goes back to the elite, of course, who use the money for big projects, which we all supposedly call public projects, big, huge projects like building railroads across continents and gasworks in Britain, waterworks and roadways. And then when they have it all working and all the problems ironed out, they sell it to each other for peanuts. You see, that's called progress. And as Marx keep doing it, we've watched this down through the centuries in Europe, as these huge projects were built up by the taxpayer. We're all working for the common good, the common good. And then, gee whiz, one day they tell you, we can't go on like this, you know, it's too expensive. We need professional people, more professional people with a motive, a profit motive to take care of. It's only incentive to make things work. So they put it up for a raffle. And of course, one of the handful of the elite Masonic buddies gets to win it for peanuts. So it's a beautiful world, this road to progress, this destiny of progress. It's never been defined to the public exactly where you're going, and that's not by chance. Although it is told to you legally through movies and novels, and even songs, because that's called predictive programming, because legally, they must tell you what they're doing. And they do all the time in the movies and novels and music. Plato described the whole technique. Today we call it a form of indoctrination, predictive programming, which means that through fiction, or through when you're enjoying yourself, through being entertained undercover, and to entertain, tain comes from tin, the cover. That when you're under the cover, your sensor part of your mind is not working. And when it's not working, you're unaware that you're being downloaded like a computer. And so all the little emotional techniques that you use and you're identifying with the hero or the female with the heroine, and there's people in between these days and all that kind of stuff. Once you start identifying with the characters, they've got you, because they can take you anywhere, no matter what that character does, because as long as you identify this much with them, they can take you that much into where they want you to go emotionally. And so when the real things start to happen in your own life, you say, well, this is kind of familiar to me. And you don't object to it, because you're thinking, well, I guess it's the only way we could go in society in this particular area. I guess it's a natural evolution. But no, your mind was prepared, because these guys are the shepherds, you know. They have another bunch of slaves and scientists that work for them who do this mind control business, and they farm us to an extent. They know what they want to grow in this field, what kind of crop they want to grow, and how high, and how many. And they first prepare the land, you know. They cut the brush. They plow it, they harrow it, they do all the necessary groundwork, and then they sow the seed and watch it grow, you see, and cultivate it. Well, that's what they do with your mind in preparation for every event that will happen in your life, every major event in your life. You've seen it all through movies, especially in this day and age, and in the last century it was primarily, well, in the 20th century, it was primarily novels and stage plays and music halls, etc. But today it's in everybody's TV, the one-eyed set, the lie of Lucifer or Ra, you know, the tale of Levi, Zion. And they program it right into you through entertainment, and then you see it happening in real life, and you think, well, I guess that's okay, it's sort of natural, isn't it? And you don't think any more beyond that. Where did that idea come from in the first place? It's marketed to you through entertainment. And that's the prime reason for entertainment. It's not for you to sit and have music while you chew the grass like good little sheep. It's to program you. And that's why you have to have big bucks to get in to the entertainment industry. Big bucks. And you must be qualified to be a very high degree Mason who knows the score, as they say. Because they can't let any Joe Blow come in. Plato said that thousands of years ago. culture is created from the top and put down to the people. We're taught it comes from the grassroots, you see, and just sort of withers or blossoms or like weeds it grows, and it doesn't, because they can't allow anything to come from the grassroots. Because it's not in their plan. You can never tell the unforetold consequences the most simplest, seemingly innocent thing could possibly do, the rippling effects, and what it would affect, and so on. So everything comes from the top down in this culture creation business. And it's always been that way in civilization. What normality was, we haven't a clue. Prior to the incoming of these characters with their system, their ancient system of money, chronology, you know, priesthoods, and merchandising, and rulerships. Ruler, of course, comes from the ruler that you use in school, a ruler. Everything is Masonic terminology. Cain is the same thing too. He's a priest, but he's also a builder. Cain was the first artificer, the first scientist who made things with metals and so on, weaponry. And you have a ruler. A cane is also a ruler. They used to use the canes, the bulrush used to make rulers in ancient Middle East. So they're rulers and they measure us, you see. And a good ruler weighs you in the balance, as you say. And if you're found wanting, he won't have you around because he wants efficiency. And that's where we're going today, with pure efficiency. School to work. School to work. Now, when you listen to the elite talking, if you ever mix amongst them, you'll hear them discuss this kind of stuff quite freely. Oh, the people need us, or the masses, the peasants, the profane, they need us. It's like saying that, you know, the mice in the field need that hawk. That's how they rationalize this nonsense. They can never look at themselves honestly, because good psychopaths cannot. They run on ego, superego. That's why they're psychopaths. And they get their way regardless of the consequences to anyone around them, because they have no empathy for others. Now, they can work together as long as they're working towards a common goal and they're all sharing the loot. But the time obviously comes when good psychopaths have to turn on each other, and it will eventually come one day, as the throne of the world comes into sight. And each one wants his name chiseled in stone, as they always do, these guys. A statue and his name chisels in stone is the first king of the whole entire planet.
He's got a heart of stone. You best leave her alone.
And they're all chomping at the bit to get it. So the cooperation won't last forever. That doesn't help the masses, of course, because in the meantime, they are being culled off. Population control councils were held by Britain under Thomas Malthus in the 1700s. And they discussed methods of culling off the excess people through disease or creating housing schemes, basically, on swamplands and unhealthy areas, the stuff that we did to the American Indians, in other words, put them in areas where they can't eat very well, and the climate isn't the best, and it's swampy, full of mosquitoes, whatever, and plagues break out, and they even had it worked out in under Malthus, that the poor houses that they created, where they threw you in when you were broke, you see, or you owed money for your rent, as most folk did, they rented in Britain, for instance, in Europe. And if you didn't have money, they'd throw you in a debtor's prison, which cost you money, by the way, that was added to what you owed. And then they kicked you out into the poorhouse, where you were forced to work till you died, and you didn't last long in the poorhouse. Most women and children lasted 6 months at the most. And this was called a more efficient way of disposing of the poor unfortunates, as we call them. This is the real history, which isn't hidden if you want to find it. It's not a nice drama, like a docudrama like TV or Anne of Green Gables. all the rubbish that they feed you, because people get most of their history today through romantic novels and stuff like that. There was nothing romantic about the 1700s, the 1800s, or the 1900s. For most people, it was a horror show. And that horror show has been slightly alleviated at the moment because the biggest change of all is coming into view, the completion of the great work, the, you know, the one that started 4,500 BC sort of stuff, where they see themselves running the world in a scientific manner. The natural order, where the stupid ones simply won't exist, as they're too stupid, and there'll be no free thought or free opinion. And we see it all today with political correctness, all this kind of stuff being forced down our throats. It's actually being implemented, and unfortunately the people themselves are their own worst enemy. It's like the Matrix 1 movie, because they show you in the Matrix movie, you know, since the elite themselves, the occult elite, gave you those movies, you're chewing on the guy you think's a good guy, but you've got it all mixed up. You see, this is themselves are talking, the new man, Neil Anderson, Andra, from the Greek Andras, man, Neil Anderson, the new son of man, the new messiah, the Superman, you know, all these superpowers. You see, that's where Superman comes from. It's the superpowers. That's the one that gets into the next stage. Those who can't do that will not be allowed into the next stage. And it's no coincidence, it's identical, this Freemasonry of the European elite. It's no coincidence, it's identical with Hinduistic theology, a caste system. Because in Hinduism, too, at the end of ages, those who are unworthy to come into the next must perish, they mustn't be allowed into the next stage. And so we see the masses spraying the skies, we see all the inoculations being dished out, people getting sicker. adolescent arthritis now, inoculations, more of them. And all the propaganda on television that were force-fed through, it's always law series or hospital series and drama, and detectives and DNA swab testing and all this stuff. It's all training you see. It's all propaganda to make you obey these authorities, these specialists, law, medicine, and the courts, and science, DNA, and scientific techniques of finding things out, you see. It's training you to accept this as a natural order, because it's nothing like the reality. Nothing like the reality. But it's good entertainment, and it's good programming for the people. And towards an end that they don't even think about, because they're not taught to think, you see. They're taught not to think, that's what we're educated for. The first thing you learn in school is to repeat after me. If you repeat after me, you get a little gold star. And if you're not repeating, and you're very good at repeating, the people will call you clever. That's nothing to do with being clever. That's being a good parrot. Repeating after me is a good parrot, but that's what they want, because then your quality approval stamp, square your head, you're now unnatural, you're dumb enough to get into their system. So that's the real system we live within, you see. It's quite funny, really. Tragically funny. Because they can't tell the people, we have been killing you. They can't tell them. You don't tell the children what you're... The poor things wouldn't understand poor dears. They wouldn't understand poor dears. We find the same thing with the Afrikaners in Africa. That's how they talk about the blacks. Well, you can't help them because they're children, really. They're children's mentalities, so you can't be straightforward with them. Well, that's how the elite treat all of us. All of us. To the elite, the peasantry of China is no lower than the peasantry in Europe or the Americas. Because they believe in elite breeding, and elite breeders of every country rule every country, therefore it's one big club. You've proven you're worth to join, you're worthy because it's Saint Masonry. Second generation Masons or first generation Masons can't get terribly high because unless they've married an Eastern Star, then they bring up a son. It's the offspring, it's a breeding program. You'll see it in the Rosicrucian books, where they keep tongue-in-cheek hinting for the very stupid, because it's meant to pick up the very stupid into these societies. And through almost, you know, stumbling over each other, they tell you that you know, selection is very important. Selective breeding is what they're getting at. Selective breeding. And don't let the lower head rule the upper head, is what they say to the men. And everybody understands that. That's why all this is in your language. So it's a breeding program, and a first generation Mason can't get up terribly high, maybe a 32nd degree in the Scottish Rite. But if he marries an Eastern Star, who's again been through a few generations, then the offspring can go higher, the son of a Mason, and in a third generation can go much higher still. So you're breeding upwards through selective breeding, and your wives are chosen for you at that level. Just like the nobility's wives have always been chosen for the men. What you do in your free time when you're not breeding is up to yourself. As long as you're both kept in a good financial style, she can do what she wants and you can do what you want. There's no love there. Love is something which is fairly new that's been marketed to the public. Because people in the past, even in the lower orders of things, married out of necessity. Male and female. And they really didn't have a good life, either one. When the Normans came into Britain and introduced this wonderful system of lordship over the public, and all subservient to the king, you know, the head hoodsman, and you have the lords and the feudal lords below them, and the sublords, the serfs, you know, and all got their own patch to guard over and use. The peasantry were bought and sold with the land, and in English they like to change it to serfs. They don't like the word slavery, because we're a Christian country, you see, and we can't have that in our history books, so we call them serfs. So 95% of the public were serfs, you see. And they were bought and sold with the land, starting from the time of the Norman invasion, who brought civilization to Europe. It's the same civilization, through slaughtering people. Massively financially backed as well. It was many years in the making, this, and tremendous logistics in keeping them all supplied at sea and on land. It was much bigger than World War II. And costing the whole thing and time. So this is an ancient system coming through here, backing it heavily. And it was a must be. They had to conquer everything and eliminate all of opposition, which they did. And they were terrible rulers. They were inhumane. Terribly inhumane. So the Normans came in and they had the Domesday Book created. You see, the Domesday Book was an inventory of all that they owned, all the king owned. And that was people, livestock, houses, children, chickens, everything. It was a complete inventory of the whole land that he owned. And that was nothing new, because the ancient pharaohs had the same system in Egypt. And it was nothing new, because the Normans also, a lord would put out his son to a relative, to an uncle or whatever, you see, another lord, and he would become taught the ways of knighthood through this relative. That was traditional with Normans. When you jump back to the pharaohs, they did the same thing, because they're their sons, but they sent off to different satraps. They call them little princes, their satrapies, and they'd get brought up and taught the ways of being noble and a warrior, a knight, you see. The same bunch all down through history. Same techniques: money, priesthoods, power, slaughter armies, and the people had to produce. Now the Normans allowed the peasantry to keep maybe 40% or so, 60% of their crops, and there was no intensive farming then. doesn't have all the high tech yada yada do today. So crops often weren't terribly huge, but the Lord would take 40 odd percent or even 60% of yours and keep enough for his staff and all his armies and sell all the rest for profit. And then profit had to split that with all the way up to the king at the top, the real mafia system. This is the most organized gang on the planet. It's a gang system, really. So we have these Normans taking that off. Well, today, when you work out what you're allowed to keep, if you work out all the taxes, hidden taxes and so on, purchase taxes and income taxes and property taxes, you're paying more than that yourself today. So it's pretty well the same, really. The only difference is they don't have to send the army around through the forest to slaughter you and beat you into submission to make you pay up. You see, we do it willingly because we're trained to do it willingly. We're trained better. We're self-maintained slaves today. Now, there are many sides to this whole system here. And on today's talk, all I'm talking about really is the physical side of things. Some of it is incredibly clever. It's by using sciences which are not taught to the general public that mind control, manipulation, they have a perfect understanding of their prey. They're the perfect predator. That's why in the coats of arms they have all these predatory animals, you see. And Albert Pike, the Grand Master, the big pope of Scottish Freemasonry in the 1800s, said we make no apologies for nature. And then he was on to talk about the different animals that hunt. So, in other words, they make no apologies for being top predators. That's their natural order. At the bottom, of course, the schmucks at the bottom, they go into the Blue Lodge in 1, 2, 3 degrees and think, well, I've made it, you know. And these guys are the little prunes who walk around collecting charity money. That's the cover for the guys at the top. Sudden virtue, they want to help people now as they take all the freebies that they're given through the system. So, there's one side which is all science, perfect understanding of human nature, all kinds of types of human nature, perfect understanding, nothing is new under the sun, as I say. There's also a religion behind this, and the religion on one level, as I say, is very Darwinistic. Darwin only espoused what they'd already been believing themselves for many thousands of years. And in the movie 2001, Arthur C. Clarke, very high Freemason, gives you the agenda of high Freemasonry, not the schmuckdom Freemasonry, but the high stuff. He gives you their agenda and their philosophy and their religion in the movie. In the beginning of the movie 2001, made in the 1960s, they show you the ape men, the hairy guys, supposedly. And the hairy guys are terrified of the darkness, and they quiver in their caves at night. And in the morning, they go across to the watering hole, and they meet this other tribe of ape men. And they shake their fists and so on each other, go through a little dance, a solemn dance. And then they have to drink and sort of muffle off in their own separate ways, and that's how it's been going on forever. And in the little sequences around it, as they're showing you this way up cake, you see it's part of their religion, you understand all this later. And they'll show you a tree branch shaped like a big snake, you see. And you see all these emblems, but these are actually Masonic emblems, occultic, high occultic emblems, you see all through it. And even though the story eventually goes into space, it starts with these cavemen, and an obelisk comes down. There's this black obelisk, and in the book is more detailed, because the obelisk pulls each caveman out one by one and makes them jump around and stuff, and it's testing them out to see who's got the best smarts. And it picks one of them, and one day the watering hole, instead of going over and shaking their fists and yadda and screaming and then having to drink and going home, this one picks up a bone because they love the skull and the crossbones, you know, of masonry, the pirate's flag. He picks up a thigh bone, and then he smashes his enemy over the water hole there, and he kills him. And that's, they're telling you, that's the right of might. The right of might. He who will kill is superior. As they give you religions about being meek and mild, they teach another one for themselves. Progress. You see, they have a thing called progress. They hate something called stagnant civilization, arrested civilizations. No, you must have progress. And progress to them is done through those who are willing to kill and become the top chutzpah, the king, king of the ape men. And then it jumps from there into the future, to the year 2001, and then a space journey occurs, supposedly on the trail of this obelisk that had been on Earth. Ends up on Jupiter, but it's all occultic, it's nothing to do with space travel. There's a Masonic initiation in it. You'll see the computer HAL on board the spaceship traveling to Jupiter, kills off two of the guys that are with him, and then tries to kill off the third guy. He outsmarts it and disables it, meaning he overcame all the natural laws. HAL is the sun, like halogen, you know, Halcyon, Halcyon the Greeks, HAL. And H-A-L, one letter after it, each one, an alphabet is I-B-M. You see, I-B-M, you speak it as I-beam, the beam from the eye of Ra. The beaming from the eye is between the pyramid, the capstone, and the rest of the pyramid. So everything is shown to you. It's not necessarily that you understand. It's only necessary that you think you understand, and everybody comes out of these movies chomping away. They're, you know, wow, it's a good movie, what's next? I have no idea what it means. And in 2010 is a follow-up to the movie, and it shows you what's supposed to happen in 2010. And so this big thing at the end where this guy who escaped the computer remembers in the next movie, he's timeless, he's ageless, he's become a god because he overcame Halcyon, you see, the sun, the natural order. He overcame all the laws, and he's a god, and a new sun appears in the sky, but as above, so below, so a new sun will appear on earth, a messiah, a being, an entity, whatever it is, that they bring forth to you, with much hullabaloo and fanfare, I'm sure. But they're telling you their system, that they show you their religion, from evolution, which is their belief system, both physical and spiritual, because they do believe in reincarnation, but they don't believe that everybody reincarnates, you know. There's a whole theology behind that. Even though I'm encouraged to believe in it amongst the lesser, as they call it, they have a different belief system for themselves, specialized one. Well, naturally, they're special, aren't they? You can't have the same one as everyone else. So there's the physical and inbreeding, which is terribly, terribly important to them, because it's part of the spiritual recycling, you might say, of the same dynasties within the same dynasties. And that's what they claim gives them their power and their intellect and their right to dominate and so on. And they give us religions. Religion is to tie, to rebind, to retie. They tie our minds down. When you're tied, you're not free to think. And we were told we're free, so that self-compensates. We were told we're free even though we're crippled at birth by the system, which of indoctrination. And now they're getting to the stage where they're going to declare their world government, their scientific established elite, bureaucracy to run us all, you see. Masses of bureaucracy. Lenin talked about it because he was in on it. He was created by the same guys. They create all oppositions. You can't get progress unless you have opposition to fight, because that's how you stir up matter. You stir up the world. You can't have one law coming this way and going through unimpeded. Apart from having no fun in that, the fact is it will never succeed. You've got to get the public to go along with it, so we need oppositions. So they give you all the oppositions, you know. And out of that comes the way that they want you to go. The two sheepdog, you know, bark, bark, and the sheep go this way. One sheepdog and trying to do it, you see, they'll run in all directions. It's beautiful, really, isn't it? So they give us good shepherds down through the ages with his little shepherd crook to pull you. And they are crooks. That's where the word comes from. They are crooks at the top. They're not very proud of it. And we have sun gods all down through the ages, and we have Marys all down through the ages. You know, virgins are always virgins. And of course, there's so many sun gods all down through the ages who come back and tell us the same stuff. And die on crosses. They always die on crosses because the sun crosses, you see, and at the meridian points and so on, and the sun is as high as this crossing. And we have the cross of the sun. And we've been conned mightily. We've fought each other over all this rubbish. We've been very predictable sheep indeed. Always learning, but never knowing. Never knowing. Data is data. Doesn't mean it's truth or anything else. We're stuffed full of incredible data today. It doesn't mean it's true. Or any of this is even necessary to know. The only person who could be natural today are maybe a few survivors in the Amazon who haven't been caught yet and handed a credit card and a cell phone. Because these so-called primitive societies, and same with some left in Borneo and different places, had no need of psychiatry or medicine or pharmaceutical agencies. Didn't know what high blood pressure was, or sugar, diabetes, or therapy, or psychoanalysis, or didn't know who Freud was, didn't care, didn't need him, or Einstein, or any of the rest of the rubbish. Because that's what they are, actually, they're rubbish, they're front men. Chosen at a particular time to push a specific dogma. They didn't create the dogmas. These primitive men, as they call them, really are probably more in tune with our reality than we could ever imagine. We'll see them staring in the jungle at a tree on their way somewhere. They'll stay there for 2 or 3 hours, maybe staring at. Well, that's got meaning for the person. To us, we say, well, what's the profit in it? What's the purpose? What's the profit, purpose? But you see, he's getting some mental healing out of whatever it is happening. And as long as he's doing it, let him live. Leave him alone. He doesn't need pills and vitalizers and all that, or TV. Or soaps, or anything else. This guy can survive in his own way, and all of his offspring will survive for thousands and thousands of years if you leave him alone. We can't. We're interdependent on the system. The system that makes us go crazy makes you interdependent on the system. Wow, we got the pills to cure you. Well, we can't cure you, but we can treat you for life. There's no profit in curing you, but Jesus, yeah. Just live for quite a few more years and keep paying us. And we'll make you feel happy or sad or whatever you want. We'll give it to you. And that's what we're told is the meaning of life, being happy all the time. That's a new phenomenon, this egosyntonic behavior. It didn't used to be taught that your purpose in life was to be happy all the time, like some sort of manic ecstasy. That's all you see now is marketed on every ad to you. If you're buying a toothbrush to an exercise machine, you're smiling people on, grinning like baboons everywhere. No matter what they're doing, they're grinning and happy. Well, they're happy, they just bought this, whatever it is. And that's what we're told, you see, is supposed to be, life is supposed to be happy. Be happy. You know, the song, that was the message, that's all it was in that dumb song. Don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy.
When you worry, your face will frown, and that will bring everybody down. So don't worry, be happy. Don't worry, be happy now.
Don't worry, be happy. Life is supposed to be an experience of all emotions. And there's in between emotions, neither happy nor sad. But you can't have that, you see. When you're neither excessively happy or sad, you might think. And if you think, that could be danger to those that rule you. That's why you're crammed with all those choices of do my thinking today. How many channels on TV can I get? Or how many radio stations? Nobody gets satellite stations for radio now, there's that many of them. Or how many video games can I play with today? But give me someone else's thoughts, because I don't want to use my own. It's too much of a burden. Thinking is a burden. In fact, when it comes to the brain chip time, and then of course the card, the active chipped ID card, which is coming, is only a partway gesture towards this. It's to condition you for the inevitable. And most people will think, oh, because it'll be marketed, the lies will be marketed to them, the purpose of it. And the public will think, well, geez, you know, this is great. I want mine. They might even give you bronze, you know, silver, gold, and platinum. They give it snob appeal. But once everyone has one, the real function will kick in once that's happened, and there'll be no more you. And this is from science meetings. World science meetings have said this. They have all this ready to go. They have to market the idea to the public. It's been done through movies at the moment, novels, cartoons even. Children think they're going to be Superman, but they're not. They might be physically as a good cyborg, but they won't be themselves. There will be no ability to even perceive of yourself as a distinct individual. And that was said at the Loyola University meeting, where they held one of these world science meetings on this very subject. So we're guided like sheep to the slaughterhouse. Most will go willingly because they've swallowed reality hoop, line and sinker as it's been presented to them. Those who understand what's going on are caught in different degrees of sides, you know, join a patriot side, join a militia side, join a this, that, the other. And all these sides are given for you by the same elite who run things at the present. They've always given us our heroes to follow, always. Albert Pike said that. We always give the people their heroes. That's why they never lose. So you don't follow people. These are the masters of manipulation. The masters of manipulation. Everything, we can beat them by learning the law and using the law against them. The only thing you can beat this is starting with yourself, because you have to know yourself and start to dominate yourself and think for yourself, because we are up against an incredible, incredible evil. I hate even using the word, because the whole English language is all Masonic and evil is just lived backwards. Everything's coded this way in the English language. So even the words we're given is a computer language for the elite, so we can speak it into existence for them. But there are other languages too, more than just that. We have other senses we can use. There's this mental imagery, there's various symbols as well. They use symbols all the time to indoctrinate us. Words and letters are just symbols. Although they have occultic meanings in masonry and higher. But ultimately, what kind of mind is running this whole thing that's not human, obviously. That's what gets you. Yeah, they've lost a human psychopath working for them. Clever psychopaths. And dumb ones too, you know. The dumb ones they generally use for executions in wartime and stuff. Torture, that kind of thing. That the more intelligent ones are up wearing suits and ties and lying to you. That's a gift that a psychopath has, is the ability to lie without emotion. And you speak well at night, no matter what they've done, without pills. So what's above all this? They can plan something such a long time ago never lose control down through the eons, is worshipped by the high elite themselves in their strange rituals. It runs all religions, even the ones that think they're opposing each other, and the subsections of the religions that think they're opposing each other. They gave all these ones to the people. What are we really up against here? And those who are willing to open Pandora's box will eventually come to this big question. Is there any white knight out there? Is there a cavalry only coming at the last minute? And hey, it's only in the books you find that, and in the novels and the movies and religions. Because you have to participate in life to offset this. And participating in life means know yourself, come alive, and use your life for it. Because if you don't, it's game over for everyone. Most people don't care about anyone else today. And that's true. I've heard it so many times. Well, thank God, by the time they bring the last part of this, and I'll be dead. I'll probably have been retired, and I'll spend my pension, and I'll be dead, thank God. Because they don't give a damn, you see, about those that they come. Which also means they don't give a damn about all their own ancestors who came before them and suffered and enslaved and so on, so that they could exit with a pension, you know. There's no continuity between the past, the present, and the future. Egosyntonic behavior has been encouraged. And it's very possible brain damage has occurred as well. Since Arthur Koestler, who worked at the United Nations and wrote a book called The Ghost in the Machine, and who worked on ways to lobotomize that part of the brain that gives you your self-awareness and your critical survival capabilities, he was working on ways to destroy that chemically, bacteriologically, through viruses, whatever. There's different segments working for the UN on this, and he wrote about it all in his book. He was all for it, right to the end. But it was just a swell idea. And he said that the elite won't need, I mean, the peasants, basically, the masses won't need those instincts anymore because the scientific elite will be making all their decisions for them. Will be managed, well managed, you see. Whereas those who manage us must keep theirs because they must retain survival capabilities so they can steer planet Earth into the future. And that's what the rules at the top talk about, of course, as they talk about us not mustn't know this kind of stuff. As children, they'll give us nightmares. Don't tell the children what we're doing. But the IQ level is dropping. It doesn't happen by you're born with an IQ. When it starts dropping, something's happened to make that happen. What can do it? Bacterial warfare, biowarfare techniques, injections. They were discussing this back in the 1700s and 1800s, using inoculations to do it at big meetings in Europe. We'll find Jacques Cousteau talking about that, David Suzuki in Canada. Have to bring down the populations. Well, they don't just talk about it. They have a Department of Population Control at the United Nations. What do you think it means? A wish list that they sit and dream about. No, it means they will implement it, and they can't tell the children. They can't tell the children, hey, you're going to have a shorter life, you're going to come down with crippling diseases, and you'll die earlier. They can't tell you the truth. You don't tell the children the truth. It's scary. So much to encompass, so much, so many directions, so many of much of the esoteric to explain to you, so much of the exoteric to explain to you, for things to start happening. So I won't be doing all of this talk. This just little intro to give you a very quick synopsis of the past and the present and where we're going in the future. Very shortly, actually. We're getting sprayed like bugs from the sky with those that have eyes to see. Like bugs, just like bucks, like you'd take a can of Raid and spray it over an anthill. That's what they think of us. And not one person in major media will talk about it. Why? Because the media is one of the most essential arms of government. It's part of government. They couldn't give you your matrix reality without it. They couldn't keep you in it without it. It's not all gloom and doom. It's not all gloom and doom at all. But before you can save others, you've got to save yourself. And to do that, you've got a lot of work to do. A lot of decisions to make. Most can't make those decisions. Most will say, hey, leave Pandora's box closed. It's scary in there. It could be dark. I might fall in. But there's always brave souls who will. And that's the ones who come alive. The dead will never make choices. The choices are made for them. So, excuse this little homemade video here. But when you're running on a shoestring, you can still get the word out if you want to. I'll talk to you again. Thanks for listening.
Never in the field of human conflict was so much owed by so many to so few.